Hey, I'm Rhonda, and this is Pat, and we're part of the Women's Ministry here at Kirkmont Church in Beaver Creek, Ohio. Things are a little non-standard right now, so we're missing our Sunday school classes and our ladies' Bible studies. We thought we would do something called Let's Talk Table Talk. So tell me about Table Talk.
Table Talk, actually, we go back to Martin Luther a long, long time ago, and he would sit around with people and talk at his table. And so now we have Table Talk from Ligonier Ministries. And Rhonda and I were talking, the March issue was on fear. And we recognized that this was prepared, you know, way back. And somehow, providentially, God had fear as the topic that we would be looking at in last month's Table Talk. So today we're going to be talking about an article called The Reality of Fear by Ed Welch.
Yes, and if you want to just stop the video and go to tabletopmagazine.com and read the article first, that's cool. If you already have it, break out your copy. And we're just going to start at the beginning because he opens up with the line, over our ever-expanding troubles, fear and anxiety have pride of place. And I kind of hate this one, right? Because I feel like sometimes we enjoy a little bit of fear and anxiety. We wear it like a badge of honor. Like somehow we don't care enough about our children if we don't worry about them more. And that bugs me because I don't think that should be our default response. I think we need to, you know, we need to give it to God. We need to look for truth to confront our fears. We don't need to feed it and let it grow, right? But Pat was talking about, well, it's not necessarily a bad thing, right? So talk about the emotion aspect, right? It's kind of neutral.
We tend to look at our emotions as either negative or positive. And oftentimes we put the wrong label on our emotions. We see fear as a negative emotion, or we see anger as a negative emotion. We see love as a positive emotion. Those things aren't always true. Sometimes fear is really a good thing. It reminds us that there is danger and we need to look around and be careful about what's going on. Anger can be righteous anger, and it can be a very good thing if we're using it to right a wrong. Love can be a negative emotion if it smothers someone else. So we tend to look at emotions, I think, in a way that is not helpful. And right now we're living in a time where there's fear, and we don't know what's coming. We don't know how to handle what might be coming. We have no way of knowing what to do. So we need to be very careful when we talk about fear. Remember, the scripture tells us that we're supposed to fear the Lord. That must be a positive thing that we're supposed to be doing.
I think so. I mean, and he jumps right in and says, you know, their greatest good, like fear and anxiety's greatest good, is that they remind us that we're small and we need Jesus, right? So it is a good thing. We just did a study of the book of Hebrews by Jen Wilkin in my Thursday morning study, and we were supposed to look at the hall of faith, right, in chapter 11 of Hebrews, and look at all these people and pick one character, right? So pick Moses or Rahab or Joshua or whoever you liked. Pick them, and we were supposed to read their story of faith, like go back to the Old Testament reference, but then we were supposed to list out every fear they might have faced. And you could kind of go down a rabbit trail with that. And you realize that they had a lot to face. They had a lot to fear, maybe much more than we give them credit for. But then the next thing she had us do was to say, what is the proper relationship between fear and faith? And what I got out of that is that fear is kind of the involuntary reaction. Like you just almost stepped on a snake. You probably were afraid for a half second, right, as it passed before your eyes. So fear is that initial response. But faith is the forward motion, right? It's the confidence in the character of God, in the truth of Scripture, in what we know Christ has done for us that moves us forward despite what we saw pass before, what in front of us, right? So faith is the forward motion, and in a sense it desensitizes us to the fear. Like if we have been through something, and God has brought us through it, then we, the next time it happens or the next time something uncertain happens, then we really should be less fearful. And I think I told you the story yesterday, Pat, about like we need to stack our stones. And this is, again, another Old Testament reference. When something significant happened in the life of so many Old Testament characters, they piled up rocks, right? And so there was just this little stack of rocks in the middle of the desert, by some stream, by some river. The story I thought of was when Joshua brought the Israelites across the Jordan River, when they're going into the Promised Land, they pass through the Jordan on dry land. And he has each of the tribes pick up a stone and stack it up on the other side. So that when the kids say, what's the stack of rocks for, right? We rehearse the good deeds of God. We retell the story of God's provision in our life. And we need to stack some stones. Instead of getting up and going straight for your phone to see what the latest numbers are on a pandemic, how about waking up and stacking the rocks and reminding yourself of what God has done and how he's faithful? Because I think that's one of the ways you deal with the reality of fear.
I think how many times in Scripture we hear God say to the Israelites, I am the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. I'm the God who brought you out of the land of Egypt and brought you into this land that I promised to give you. He's constantly rehearsing for them, you know, this is your history. This is who you are because of me. And our first reaction is usually not that. It's our first reaction is fear. And then the question is, what do we do with that fear? Do we use it to take us to back to Scripture, back to who God is, back to what he's doing? Or do we wallow in the fear, pick up our phone, look at numbers, text a friend and say, you know, hey, I'm worried about this? Or do we remember who God is and what he reminds us he's done?
Can I just say, don't worry with your friends. Don't jump on that bandwagon, okay? Like, don't feed that appetite. Remind them of what God has done. Show them your stack of rocks, okay? Yeah. Don't jump in on that because it's all too easy and it is sort of our default. He says in the article, he talks about, you know, your fears are everywhere, right? And they live under all these other words. Pat brought up that his connection to guilt and shame. You know, he says they are tied to guilt and so many other everyday struggles. If you feel guilty, you fear judgment. If you feel shame, you fear being exposed, being seen and exposed before others. He says that anger is often fear that has some fight left in it. It sees something that you love is at risk, and it's inclined to take a stand rather than freeze or run, right? So he kind of delineates our fears a little bit, mm-hmm. and, you know, makes them a little too friendly almost, yeah. or a little too familiar. We can get in the place where he talks about, you know, almost PTSD, where something bad has happened and something bad will happen. And again, I think this is where we stack up the rocks. Right? We don't focus on something bad has happened, so something bad must happen again. We focus on the truth that we know of who God is and his kindness and his provision for us, and we focus on that rather than all the bad that might happen. Because I don't know about you, but I tend to make things worse.
Oh, yeah. Catastrophize.
Yeah. I pretty much build up something that's way, way more terrible than what actually happens, usually.
Yeah. He says in the article that fear reminds us that we are small and that we need Jesus. And I think that is where we need to be, not necessarily where we are all the time, and especially not right now. We know that we're small, but then we forget the second part. We need Jesus.
Well, and the next part of the article, he goes through this idea that Scripture assumes some fear is there, right? It says, he quotes Psalms 56, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you, right? He doesn't say, if I ever happen to doubt for a moment the sovereignty of God. No, he says, when I am afraid, I trust in you. So he knows it's going to happen. And we talked about this a little bit yesterday, but fear is, it's an artifact of the fall, right? There was no naked and afraid until after they had sinned. So I think it comes from that break in the trust, the relationship with God and man, and all of a sudden now we're on the other side of the fall, and it's not the same relationship, and that really impacts the way we experience fear. It's not just the awe and reverence aspect of a holy God. It's a recognition of an unrighteous sinner in front of a holy God. So he also talks about in the article what we should expect to find in Scripture. I think sometimes people, particularly in a global spanning crisis like the one we're facing right now, people might tend to jump on the punishment bandwagon or condemnation, that God is somehow up there lashing out at his people. And we almost expect the worst, right? And Dr. Walsh points out that when you go to Scripture, you don't see that. You see compassion. You see Christ entering in to people's stories, right where they are with what's going on right then and there, and that we really should expect kindness and compassion. We should expect comfort from Christ with us, from God with us, right? Father Emmanuel. You want to do the second one where the Lord promises that he's with us, he'll never leave us or forsake us?
Yeah, I think we have a hard time with that because we're physical, we're tangible, God is not. And so we have a hard time remembering, even though the Lord says he will never leave us, he will never forsake us, he's always with us, we have a hard time grasping onto that. One of the things that I've had a lot of trouble with as we've been sheltering in place is I miss getting hugs from people. And it's real tempting for me to reach out to Rhonda right now and touch her. And I know that I should not touch her. But there is such a sense in having someone touch you that they are caring for you. And we don't feel that with the Lord because he's spirit and not physical. So we have to keep reminding ourselves over and over again, what he says is true. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. He's always with us. And so we have to hang on to that as much as we possibly can. And he said in the article, fearful people are the ones who are in a position to cherish the gospel. We need to keep telling ourselves that story. We need to keep hearing that story for ourselves. We need to keep telling one another that story and keep reminding one another, you know, you're in a hard place right now. We're all in a hard place right now, but God is with us, and hang on to that. Yeah.
The last thing he touches on in the article, he says, the Lord is present, and he is the God who is sovereign over tomorrow, and we can give our full attention to our God-given mission today. Have you thought about your God-given mission today? Or are you too worried about tomorrow? Or as I told Pat yesterday, I'm dusting baseboards, like just to avoid doing the things, the tasks that I know I really should be focused on.
I am not dusting baseboards.
Maybe I'm only dusting them in the figurative sense in case my husband is going to check. But, you know, we tend to distract ourselves, whether it's, you know, us doing it or the enemy doing it, but we distract ourselves with a myriad of other things, right? And now God has said, stay home. Don't touch anybody. You're right here with these people, this family, right, that you cherish and love. So what is your God-given mission today? And focus on that.
Yeah. Ed Welch in the article referenced Matthew 6:33, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you as well. And then he goes on to verse 34, which tells us every day has enough trouble of its own. So don't be worrying about tomorrow, because today we have enough that we need to be thinking about. And that's a really good place for us to be. That's our God-given mission for right now.
He wraps up, or tries to wrap up the article by saying, today we have all the grace we need. Today we have the Spirit of Power who gives us courage for small steps of obedience even when tomorrow seems quite bleak. Now, when Pat and I rehearsed this the first time, I just jumped all over her with that. She's like, oh, I love that line. And I'm like, come on, it's a bunch of church words. Like, it's all vague and just out there. What does that really mean to the single mom who just lost her job, who's at home with her kids and doesn't know how to do this crazy math that they're doing, right? What does that mean in person? And then I got schooled last night, and God kind of showed me a few things that maybe I was missing the point, that it is an absolutely true statement to say we have all the grace we need, right? 2 Corinthians says, my grace is sufficient for you, right? We do have the grace we need. We're misdefining our terms, okay? And I thought of an illustration. Maybe it'll resonate with you because nobody can go anywhere right now. But if we could go somewhere and your husband goes, I'm taking you on this grand vacation and we're going to do all these fun things, we're going to have a hard time packing, right? We're going to overpack because we're in this scenario of, well, if we go here, I might need this. And what if these shoes? And if I wear this dress, then I'll need this. And then this jewelry goes there. And we end up like just piling on all this stuff, but we need it. Right? We say that we need it. If you live in Northern California and there's a wildfire headed your way and you need to leave your house right away, it's not that hard to pack, right? You grab the kids, you grab the dog, you grab your purse and you're gone, and you'll figure out the rest later, right? So I think sometimes God will use circumstances to redefine our needs. And our need ultimately is for Him, right? We are sinners in need of reconciliation with our God. So we do have all the grace we need. And then we talked a little bit about small steps of obedience.
Yeah.
Who did you call?
I called my friend. I said to Rhonda, I've been meaning to call this person for 3 days. She's been on my mind, and I keep thinking, oh, I'll give her a call. No, I won't do it right now. I won't clean the baseboards. You clean the baseboards. I'll find something else I have to do. And as Rhonda and I were talking yesterday, she said, call her. And so when I got off the phone with Rhonda, I called my friend just to check in and say, how are you doing? We had a wonderful conversation. I'm so glad that I got to connect with her. For me, that was a small step of obedience. It wasn't a big thing. It wasn't a big thing for either one of us. But for me, it was a small thing that I could do that would remind her that there's somebody who's thinking about her, who cares about her, who loves her. And I think we need to be thinking about, what is the small step of obedience that I can take right now, that I can take today, that will help people remember that someone loves them, that Jesus cares about them.
So that's kind of our summary of Dr. Welch's article, The Reality of Fear. And I think the takeaway really is that fear is there. We can expect it. But we need to trust in the goodness of God, the truth of His character and who we know Him to be, by focusing on Scripture. And we need to stack our stones and remember His goodness, His kindness to us and to the people around us, and go obey in those small steps.
Yeah.
So next time we will probably go through the second article by Keith Evans. It's called Fear of a Changing World, because we're all on board with that, right? So if we do this again, if we don't get too freaked out about what we sound like or look like on camera, then we'll talk about Fear of a Changing World next time.